Good morning, students. Welcome back to our Economics of Regulation class. Today, we are capturing Chapter 6, Price Regulation by a Fully Informed Regulator, and I just want to jump to the respective chapter. Finally, we get to the point where we look into regulation by a regulator who is perfectly informed, that's the first point, and who is benevolent, that is, the regulator wants to maximize social welfare. Unfortunately, of course, there are some constraints in the Ramsey-Bourdieu pricing. The first topic we are covering today, the constraint will be that there cannot be paid any transfers because transfers are not available or can only be financed by distorted taxation and so on. And we will look into what happens in this case. Okay, so we get a break-even constraint here. The second topic will be peak load pricing. Here the regulator has to take into account that demand is volatile or fluctuates, so we will have peak and off-peak times. And the question is then, how much will you or do you want to invest in capacity, and who should pay for this capacity? Okay, that's what today's topics are, and I just want to move on to this general setup here, just in a sense doing the same once again. So our starting point is a legal monopoly that offers a service, and this legal monopoly is regulated by a regulator who has perfect knowledge. That is, the regulator knows demand, knows cost, knows pretty much everything. So he's like God, benevolent, omniscient, and so on. And our starting point again is a natural monopoly. That is, we assume we have subadditivity. Okay, I could also mark this here so that you also know where I am. So we have subadditivity, decreasing average costs typically, and we abstract from any problems with a firm which is not cost minimizing. So that's what we talked in, or what we discussed in terms of Harvey Leibenstein's X inefficiency. The starting point is also that the first best is not possible, so no price equal marginal cost, because that would require transfers financed by some lump sum taxes. In the opposite, we have what is called a break-even constraint, so our firm needs to get sufficient revenue that it can cover, in particular, its fixed cost. In Germany, we would call that Eigenwirtschaftlichkeitsprinzip or Kostendeckung. So the regulator's problem is then a second best problem, and the regulator has to determine the optimal prices. And there are two cases. I already mentioned that. The first one is we have a multi-product firms. That will be our example of Ramsey-Bourdieu pricing. In the end, we will also shortly discuss multi-part tariffs. The most important example is two-part tariffs. And the second big part in today's lecture will be peak load pricing, in German Spitzenlastpreise, where you have fluctuating demand, and of course, how much of the demand you satisfy depends on how much you invest in capacity, and therefore we have a capacity decision, and a capacity is endogenous, as we call it. So the starting point here is, or the big question is, what should a fully informed regulator do? So this is typically what we discussed last time here, a normative approach, and we don't ask what regulators actually will do. Okay, so far hopefully it's clear, because then we can jump right into these Ramsey-Bourdieu prices. They go back to, I think it was a Cambridge mathematician, Frank Ramsey, born at about 1900 and died at the age of 28, and wrote three or four very famous papers. Another interesting point is Marcel Bourdieu is interesting because he wrote famous papers as well, and he was president of Electricité de France. And so this is really interesting that you get the president in his earlier time writing very path-breaking or groundbreaking economic papers. Okay, Ramsey-Bourdieu pricing. Later on you will see, even though that sounds all perhaps rather abstract, Bourdieu actually introduced this concept and then introduced both peak load pricing and Ramsey transporteur prices than for ADF. And as you will see later on in a case study, Ramsey Porteur prices are currently used a lot in the setting of what is called track access charges, Trassenpreise, that is the charges train operating companies have to pay to the railway infrastructure manager for using the rail tracks. Okay, so later on we will get back to these case studies, so to make you clear that this is not just complicated math, but it's really an important concept in regulation, which is currently really heavily used. Okay, so now we have our starting point, the standard welfare maximization problem, and subject to this break-even constraint. And what we are doing is we maximize welfare, and of course here if we have a break-even constraint and therefore the budget of the firm will be balanced anyway, so the profit of the firm will be zero, the only thing that counts in terms of welfare is consumer surplus. And I will make a few more notes or points about consumer surplus in a minute, and you will see why I added the net consumer surplus here. Typically, we assume that we have a multi-product firm which sets n different prices if it sells n different products, and of course sets n different quantities. And we might think first of all in terms of electricity. We might think of different times of day. So very often you have, or actually in the past before we had these huge expansion in terms of, say, photovoltaic and electricity produce a higher percentage of electricity produced during daytime. Before that, we had different tariffs for, say, daytime electricity consumption, nighttime electricity consumption, weekend electricity consumption. So you could have different prices for that. You could also have different prices for calls during daytime or business hours, during nighttime, during weekends, and so on. That would be just different products. And it could also be different consumer groups, because think in terms of electricity, you have different times for different prices for households, that is residential customers, and for small business customers, and for large businesses. Okay, so here you see you either get really different products determined, for instance, distinguished by the time of day, or you get different consumer groups. The important thing is that you can set up different segments. Okay, now we maximize either by choosing price or quantity. That doesn't matter. That's like in a monopoly problem. And our basic assumption is that price discrimination is possible. And this is just an instance of what we call third-degree price discrimination or group price discrimination. That is just residential customers pay a different price than business customers, or customers paying or consuming between 8 in the morning and 6 in the afternoon pay a different price than consumers, or a consumption which takes place during night hours. Okay, hopefully it's clear so far. What we need here is just to think about what consumer surplus means in a world with multi-products. It's a slight complication. I don't want to mention it too much here. So what is net consumer surplus? It's just the area under the demand curve. And that's what we previously have. The new point here is, of course, that we now have n different products. That's why we have this sum. And we previously already discussed it. And before I jump back to this diagram, I also want to show you what gross consumer surplus is. We define that pretty much the same way, and we did that previously. You have exactly the same thing, but here we use the inverse demand function and again sum up overall potential products. And just to illustrate that, I jump back to the slide we had in the very beginning when we introduced consumer surplus in a single product case. So again, what is gross consumer surplus? Gross consumer surplus, GCS, that's what we, I have to check here. GCS was here just the whole area if that's our price, the whole area below the inverse demand function, that is the demand curve, that would be GCS, okay, and gross and excuse me, net consumer surplus would just be I have to do it like this here. Net consumer surplus would be this area, so we integrate in a horizontal way rather than a vertical way right now. So you see, that's just concepts we already had. The important or the complicated thing now is if you have a multi-product firm and several products. Suppose this is a demand for product one. The problem is that given the price of product one, that doesn't change. If the price of product two changes and the two products are say substitutes, if the price of product two changes, this demand curve will move. Okay, so we always have to take into account the other prices. And that's where we get some complication here. I will only make one sentence. Okay, now the problem is, and that's why I do here some strange things. If you wonder why we have a p-bar, this is a so-called line integral. In the 80s, if I would have given this course, I would have spent probably a few hours on that and on the discussion, what is the difference between consumer surplus, equivalent variation, compensating variation, and so on. We will very briefly go into that in the tutorial class next Tuesday when we discuss concepts like the expenditure function, like the indirect utility function, and so on. The most important point is here, what we assume typically is so-called quasi-linear utility functions, where we don't have any so-called income effects, and then it doesn't matter where we use consumer surplus, where we use equivalent variation and compensating variation. Okay, I will get back to that. So the point here is, and that should become even clearer later on, you have several different products, you have several different of these triangles, of these integrals. I just erase here. So many different integrals, and the problem is that the integral for one demand curve changes, then another price changes. So if you look at product I, the point is product I, this area changes if price one changes, for instance. And hopefully it's now clear what the consumer surplus are and what the gross consumer surplus are. Remember, the one thing the gross consumer surplus also includes, in a sense, payments, the revenue or the expenditure of the firm. Okay, and net consumer surplus is just this small triangle, as always. Now, we need one further key property of the consumer surplus, and that's the derivative with respect to price and quantity, respectively. And with respect to a certain product I, and what we see that this yields demand. So we get the price is even to the willingness to pay for these products. Now, what is the starting point here? How does your consumer surplus change if the price of a certain product increases by, say, one euro or 1 cent? And now the very nice thing, which is related to Roy's identity, is that this is simply minus Q minus your consumption of that product. And we will look into Roy's identity briefly on next Tuesday. I think I distributed that with the assignment, some general notes about properties of utility function, of expenditure function, of maximum value functions, and so on. We will get back to that. The only point is, just if you look into,
probably it doesn't work well because it's upside down here. That's what we have here. You see, I have this theory of demand. I got this from a former colleague of mine. The point is here, however, this is Roy's identity. Unfortunately, I cannot, I should turn it. Here's what we have in terms of ROAS identity. I don't want to explain it right now, but the point is we will get back to that. The only point is here is a minus missing. Okay, a minus should be somewhere here. We will get back to that on, but only if you're confused, here is a minus missing, and we will get back to that on Tuesday. Okay, just going back so you don't have to bother more, I just want to give you some intuition for why this is really the case. It has got some, in formal terms, it has got something to do with the so-called envelope theorem, and we will look into that on Tuesday, but the idea should be rather clear-cut why we have this change in consumer surplus if the price increases by 1 euro. Suppose you consume 10 units of a product which costs you, I should give another example, suppose you pay for your phone calls and you make 100 minutes of phone calls each month, and the price of phone calls increases by 1 cent. What does this mean? What is at least your, what is your damage? And actually it tells you it's just these minus your quantity. It's minus 100 times this 1 cent. So it would be 1 euro. Okay. And similar with it, with respect to the gross consumer surplus, how does gross consumer surplus, if you get one unit more, actually it changes just like the price, which is nothing else than your willingness to pay. Again, I think it's easier to look into that with the help of our diagram. Oh, unfortunately, it's the same problem as just here. So what is the how does consumer surplus change if your price increases by 1 euro? So here, first price, then we go up by 1 euro, and you see if it's only marginal, you just lose Q. Okay, this is just Q, your original consumption, and you lose exactly this 1 times Q. Okay, and of course that's why we get a negative, a minus always here, because consumer surplus goes down. Similar thing for if you look into how, so this was how this consumer surplus changes. You just get rid of this small, it's almost a rectangle. If gross consumer surplus changes because you get 1 unit more of Q, so here is what you see. I don't know where you can see it. You see this extra unit actually gives you utility, which is nothing else than the willingness of to pay you had initially, which is equal to this initial price. That's what you get. Okay? That's what we have. And hopefully this was clear so far. So I jump back and forth, but hopefully I will manage it. So that's what we have. In the slides I distributed to you, then there is two complicated slides where I try to prove that this is exactly the case here. The point is that these properties are rather straightforward and well established, and in particular they are rather intuitive. So if you increase the price of a product, your loss is just equal to the quantity of you consumed it, because you are already in an optimizing situation, so a slight change won't change your utility apart from what is called here the direct effect, and similar with respect to gross consumer surplus. I hope that's clear so far. Okay, we will get back to that later on anyway and explain it several times. So I move on here and finally show you how to derive the so-called Ramsey prices. We have our optimization problem. Now here we start in terms of maximization of the Q. Okay, later on I will also derive it in terms of P, that is their P's, our choice variable. At the moment we chart a charge with Q, and what we maximize is just gross consumer surplus. This is just total welfare in a sense, because the whole area below or total gross welfare, I have to call it, the whole area below the demand curve minus cost. So this is standard social welfare. And of course, we have to take into account this break-even constraint here, that the firm has to have sufficient revenue in order to cover its cost, where of course the revenue is just the revenue from each different products, and we have actually n of them. And so what we get from this optimization problem and what we have to derive are the different values, the optimal values of the different of the different products. There is one thing here I just want to add before I move on to the Lagrangian. So if you look at Deutsche Bahn, or I did a study once in Austria with respect to Österreichische Bundesbahn and Austrian Railways, typically they don't have a balanced budget anyway, so they make some losses which are covered for by the federal government. So they this is supposed to mean a set, they receive some subsidy set, and that's what you can easily add here. So they Deutsche Bahn, either they should have to pay some dividend, then this would be a negative subsidy, that is a tax, or they get some, we have a Leistungs- und Finanzierungsvereinbarung, performance and financing agreement, or they get some subsidies when we would just add this here. Okay, the point simply is that the subsidies are not enough to capture all the fixed costs, and so that we cannot realize this first best situation. Okay, I will get back to this set later on, and we can discuss it further on. Now, the problem is straightforward. We maximize total surplus here, gross consumer surplus minus cost, which is nothing else than net consumer surplus plus profit, by the way. Okay, and we set up a Lagrangian here where we add the constraint with a Lagrange multiplier. Of course, here we could also add here our plus set if we had the set up there. And lambda is the shadow price of the constraint. That is that's what you see here very nicely. If you have the set, if you would take the derivative, just do the derivative of this Lagrangian with respect to set, and you get namely lambda. What does this mean? What do we get in terms of additional welfare or in terms of consumer surplus if we pay one more euro of subsidies? And this is just some value which probably should be higher than one, otherwise we shouldn't pay it. This is what we get here. So if we subsidize that by how much, if we subsidize it by 1 euro, our regulated company, how much does utility increase? Hopefully this is clear so far, because then I would move on and do our standard optimization, approach, where we take the derivative with respect to the different quantities and with respect to the Lagrange multiplier. That's what we get here. Okay, taking the derivatives, this is what should be standard. Now you see that this looks a bit ugly, just taking the derivative of gross consumer surplus minus cost plus here the lambda times here also the derivative. And even though this looks ugly, remember, and hopefully that comes right now, but we just derived an important result, namely because if we change gross consumer surplus by one unit of an output, we just get the willingness to pay the price of this output as the result. And of course, we also have that revenue is just the sum of the individual revenues. So now it looks much nicer immediately. Okay, so here the P is nothing else than here the result from the derivative of gross consumer surplus with respect to Q. The C is what we define here as marginal cost. And this is just the derivative up here of the total cost function with respect to this simple output qi. And then we get the lambda. And actually, now, this is an ugly expression here. Why is that so? Of course, here, if we take the derivative with respect to c, again, we get marginal cost. But this is something like, it's like a marginal revenue, but it's a generalized marginal revenue. And we will get back to that. Why is it generalized? Now, the point here is that if we change qi, the price pj will also change. And how does it change? That's a question. So the point here is, suppose these were Volkswagen. If they want to produce or to sell more, say, Turans, they probably, given the quantity of the Golf, if they want still to sell the same number of Golfs, if they want to sell more Turans, they have to reduce the price of the Turan. But if they want still keep on selling the same number of Golfs, which is a substitute for many, they would also have to decrease the price of the Golf. So you get effects on other products as well. That's what's complicated, and it's getting more complicated even later on, because this effect here would be negative typically, and if you do it the other way around, it's not negative, but you only will get that later on. But the point here is, if you change the quantity of one product, of course, you will also have to adjust the price of that product, but also the prices of other products change. You have an effect on other products as well. In the Wettbewerbspolitik, in the competition policy lecture in the intermediate course, this is like in a merger. In a merger, if BMW and Daimler merges, they have always to take into account, if BMW wants to sell more cars, that has an effect on Daimler as well. That's somehow the effect which arises here. Okay, so we just move on to playing around with what we have here in terms of this first order condition. This is just the same first order condition I just reproduced it. And now I want to do something, so I just put this lambda thing here on the other side. First of all, I put this p here with a 1 plus lambda, so we get a 1 plus lambda, and put that then off the other side. That's, so with the 1 plus lambda, you get that here, and divide both sides by that. So you put it on the other side, divide by p, and then you see why you do that, because now it looks already much nicer, even though the sum is still not nice. And you might think that this looks very familiar, because it looks like an elasticity. Unfortunately, it is not really one. It's only close. Okay, it's only an elasticity if you have I equal to j. So that is, if you look into, so this j covers all products, of course, also including product I, and so it's an elasticity then, but it's not an elasticity for the other ones. In the two products case, it looks nicer and it's clearer. That's why I look into that. Here you see this sum you get here. I don't know whether I didn't do this here. This is nothing else than our own price elasticity, epsilon. I could call it, not nicely written here. It's epsilon 1 1. Looks like 1 2. So it's the price elasticity of product one with respect to the demand of product one. And what you see here is, here we have the learner index. Here we have a price, on the other side we have a price elasticity and some proportionality factor. Unfortunately, the last term here is not a price elasticity. That's why I have these numbers here. It looks like a cross price elasticity, but if it were really a cross price elasticity, we would need here a Q1 and a P2. Okay, I will get back to that in a minute. I think we first look into a simpler case, namely independent demands. independent demands. What does independent demands mean? Yeah, it simply means that Turan and Golf is unrelated in terms of our industries with independent demands. So if you think Deutsche Telekom offers both local calls and far distance calls, in former times these you didn't have a flat rate and you had different prices for local calls and far distance calls. Okay, and so the point is, if for instance the price of local calls increased and far distance call stayed constant, you might perhaps may have fewer local calls, but you hardly substitute to far distance calls. Okay, you don't call your mother more, your parents more often, who live farther away, if it becomes more expensive to call your friends living with you in the same world, same city. Okay, so here you would say there is independent demands. However, if you say in terms of electricity prices, if you have different prices for daytime electricity and nighttime electricity, so if the price for daytime electricity increases, you might have an effect that some people start to run their washing machines during nighttime. So there you wouldn't have independent demand. So here is the important thing is that if you want to increase, it's more interesting to or easier to do it the other way around here. If you increase the price of one product, it doesn't affect the quantity of the other product if you have independent demand. Okay, so they are pretty much unrelated. And if they are unrelated, that's what we are looking into here. And you are then in a very, very easy world, of course, here. If you think in terms of our different consumer segments, if you increase the price of, say, residential customers, that will hardly affect the consumption of business customers, okay, if their price is unchanged. If you increase the price for freight transport on railways, that probably won't affect the demand for passenger transport. However, if you increase the price for far distance transport, people might go more and use more local transport services in order to go from one city to the other. They just use local train services for longer distance. So here you see, this is just an empirical question whether demands are independent or not. And of course, if they're independent, that's what you are going to see right now. Life is easier. Now, because why is life easier? Because here, if demands are independent, this expression here will be zero. Okay? There's no cross effect. Yeah, and if you have that, it looks perfect, because then we get the famous inverse elasticity rules. You just saw, and again, it's easier here. This is nothing else than, actually, it is not the demand elasticity. It's 1 over the demand elasticity, because the demand elasticity always has price in the denominator. And that's what you have here, okay? I think on the next slide, I just have the explanation. That's why I move on here. This is the famous inverse elasticity rules. This is the one you always also have for the unregulated monopolist, even though the level is different, because you see here is something which is smaller than 1 lambda over 1 plus lambda is certainly smaller than 1. So you get a lower markup. However, you get the same structure. So the point, what does inverse elasticity mean? If elasticity is low, the markup will be high. If elasticity is high, the markup will be low. Okay, so people who have an elastic demand will pay little. People who have, or consumer groups who have inelastic demand will pay a lot, and we will get back to that later as well. Okay, and that's what I told you already. The price cost margin, which is nothing else than a Lerner index, is proportional to the inverse elasticity of demand. And what Boateau Turk called that is that markups according to what the market can bear. And so the point is here, if you have a high elasticity, you can't bear much, you have to leave this market. If prices increase, if you have a low elasticity, you will be able to bear more. And finally, so these super elasticities, I will get back to that. Just a final point with respect to the lambda. Remember, lambda is, in a sense, the shadow price of the constraint. Of course, this constraint, so how much losses can you make, for instance. Remember, if the important point was that we have economies of scale and natural monopoly here. If you have no fixed cost, you don't have a natural monopoly, and therefore the lambda would be zero, okay? And if lambda is zero, you see price would be equal to marginal cost. On the other hand, remember, if fixed costs are very high, we had this example where fixed cost or where the monopoly profit was 2,499 or something like that, and if fixed costs were equal to that, a monopolist could just break even, okay? And if fixed costs are very high, actually, lambda approaches infinity, and infinity divided by infinity is actually one here in this case, and you would just end up with the monopoly solution. Yeah, when products are not independent, it gets ugly because you get these so-called super elasticities, which, as I noted yesterday night when I went through it, are even more complicated than I thought originally. Okay, so we have then what we have here, we might just rearrange that to get a real cross price elasticity. However, this is not a real cross price elasticity. The point here is it's a difference whether you derive them from the inverse demand function from the demand curve, or whether you derive them from the demand function itself. Okay, so you get a different result. We will look into that on Tuesday, and I just jump here to assignment 4. We can briefly look into that, or we can further discuss what that means once we look into this so-called linear quadratic utility function, where we can derive these elasticities in two ways, first based on the inverse demand function and then on the demand function, and then you will see why I got these problems. The point is what you will see later on, and in terms of our problem sets, we mostly just abstract from these cases where we have interdependent demands, because they are really hard to calculate and it takes so long. Okay, so the point is here, if you have these super elasticities, that's how I put it here. I will discuss in more detail why these are pseudo elasticities. Because you take the derivative first you take the derivative of the demand curve rather than the demand function with respect to Q1, rather than just the opposite. And what you get here is this, and Chartier-Roll and Jean-Jacques Lafont in their books Competition in Telecommunications interpreted that in a way which is not so clear. So the important point is here that in this situation, I already showed you, told you that this sign of this thing here, sign, is negative. Okay, what does this mean? And that's a conclusion you or Tirol and Lafont draw, is that of course if that's negative, here we get then something positive, and it's negative if it's substitute. Okay, that's the important point. Sign negative if substitute. So I have trouble to write that down here. If substitutes, that's my Golf and Turan example, then it's negative. And then is what you get is, if you take that into account, you get a higher markup. Okay? And as this is so ugly, I just presented some numerical results here, where I pretty much just used the linear quadratic utility function we will discuss in more detail on Tuesday. Here is an important parameter, which is S, which is just a substitution parameter. If S is zero, these are independent products. If S is positive, or if S is 1, this would be homogeneous products. If it's 0.7, it's just substitute. If it's negative, it's complements. Okay? And what you see with independent products, you get something, marginal cost is 0 here, and so you get some markup in order to cover the fixed cost here. And here you get even the lambda, which has a quite small value here. And you see you get a certain different prices here. You get two different demands. Basically, the one has a higher vertical intercept than the other. So this A1 would be the more elastic demand, or demand for product 1 would be the more elastic demand. And what you see is it has a lower price. And here, if you have substitutes and you get exactly the result we just discussed, is that here markups are higher. Unfortunately, the point is, if you have this kind of approach, the Boole approach with the linear quadratic utility, also quantities change. And of course, if you have a lower quantity, you have to have a higher markup in order to cover the fixed cost. If you have complements, you have much higher demand, and therefore you have also lower markups, and that somehow is then in line with what I interpreted here, because you shouldn't rely on a simple example, on only one example. I drove a second, or I drew up a second one now with a Shubik-Levitan, which utility, and this looks very similar. Apart from that quantities stay the same. That's what you see better here. You see total quantity is almost the same over all mu's. Now, previously, our parameter which accounted for the substitution was the S. Now it's the mu. For me, mu approaching infinity, this will be homogeneous products. For mu being zero here, it will be independent products. And for mu in a negative territory, it will be complements. Perhaps probably next year I add the Shubik-Levitan example also to the assignment, so that you can derive the properties of that as well. But for the moment, I don't have them. And what I do here is, however, I show you how the prices look like here. And you see, this would be the uniform price. So if both consumer groups pay the same price, and what you see is something like the opposite of what we just had. Again, our marginal cost is zero. But what you see here is for complements, you have a higher markup than for substitutes. Okay, so in a sense, you seem to get other results if you just argue from the viewpoint of the first order condition. The first order condition was just this here, okay? Or whether you calculate the whole equilibrium, because here you have to take into account that somehow quantities also change. Okay, and what you see in terms of prices, in terms of quantities, what you see here is prices go down. If it's more a substitute here, the axis origin is at a y value of 4. So you have a price of 4, and what you see here with 4, x1 just vanishes. If the two products are substitutes and you have a higher willingness for product 2, you just set prices as a regulator so that no one buys product 1 anymore. Okay. And here you keep the total output in a sense constant. But what is also interesting here is that with complements, even the low value product 1, A1 of 150, is consumed in higher quantity than the high value product just due to this complementarity. Okay, so this is really complicated in a sense, and what we expect from you, or what I expect from you, is that you can pretty much solve that for independent demands. I just wanted to give you this indication so that you run into trouble once you have interdependent demands, and you see then it's good to have some numerical illustration where you see how your prices change with demand elasticity and so on. Okay, so as I told in WebEx, this is really hard stuff, and I just want to present you the second way to derive these results, which is slightly different. It moves on from prices as a choice variable, and hopefully it becomes now clearer. We have the same optimization problem. Remember that net consumer surplus is just gross consumer gross consumer surplus is net consumer surplus plus revenue or plus expenditure. So this is nothing else than our gross consumer surplus. We just put it in terms of net consumer surplus because that we defined in terms or as a function of prices. And here we have then nothing else than total surplus, because net consumer surplus plus profit. Okay, again we have our break-even constraint, and we take the derivatives now with respect to P in order to get the different prices. We get very similar conditions. Remember that the derivative of the consumer surplus with respect to price I is nothing else than minus QI. Okay. And here the 1 plus lambda is just from the fact that you have revenue minus cost, that is a profit, here in the objective function as well as in the constraint which you add by the lambda. That's why you get the 1 plus lambda. And if you take a derivative of the revenue with respect to P, revenue is nothing else than, where QI is a function of all the P's, and if we take the derivative dr dp, we get dr d say q. You get all the Q's. That's why you get here this sum here, but just general dqj dpi. That would be only a single one, okay, and you sum that up, and dr dq is another complicated guy, because dr dq gives you first you get a it's even more complicated because here it's a product rule plus that's why it's so complicated. Here this was the derivative with respect to the first argument, and then we also need the derivative with respect to the second argument, which is just P, which just would leave you with QI in this case. Okay, and now it's probably confused, but that's how we get that. Again, same thing, and dr dq, if you take drdqj is nothing else than pj. Okay, that's what you get here. That's how you come up with this result. So you just should do it in a silent moment at home, and then you will see that this is really just what you get. Again, of course, this is now not marginal revenue, because marginal revenue is defined as the derivative with respect to quantity of the revenue function. Now it's just the derivative with respect to prices, and you get all this. Okay, and what we are doing here, and that's the complicated thing, you always have to have an idea how to rearrange that in order to get a sensible result, and I rearranged it here to get this, and you see again you have these P minus C here somewhere, and you get the elasticities, and in your slides, you don't have this previous slide here. And we move on in a minute with the case where we have linear demand, because it's much easier then. But yesterday, just before midnight, I encountered this problem. This is cross elasticity, so that no, and I just set that up here. If for the two goods case, I don't want to go through it because it's even more confusing. But here you get the super elasticities, that is, you have this elasticity, the own price elasticity, and all these cross price elasticity. I didn't give you the definition here, but this epsilon 2,1 would simply be the derivative, would simply be this here, okay? The elasticity of product 2 with respect to price 1. And just to show you that this is something also, if you're interested in that, Jean-Jacques Lafont and Jean Tirole derive in their book Theory of Incentives in Procurement and Regulation. The point is here again, now you really get cross-price elasticities, which are standard, that is, cross-price elasticities where if you have substitutes, the cross-price elasticity is positive. Why does it matter? Okay, if the price of the substitute goes up, your demand for the product will go up. Okay, if the price of an Audi increases, the price for the demand for BMWs will increase. Okay. I leave it at this here. I never will ask you about that again. And just that you see that can be done. Okay, but I just jump back to our function here. So it's too quick again, of course. So our starting point was this first order condition. Okay, this first order condition is nothing else than this final condition here. Okay, that's what we are doing right now. And what we are doing right now is just assuming that we get independent demands and linear demands. So all cross effect where you don't, where you have a QJ and a PI and J is not equal to I, they just vanish. Okay, then really life gets much cheaper, and as you will see in the tutorial class, it gets much cheaper than once you assume something like this here. Okay, and if you substitute that, here's nothing else, the B is nothing else than just the derivative of the demand function with respect to the price here. This would be minus B, and we get lost of some or we lose some minus here, but that's exactly what we get here. Okay, and now we play around with this situation, and here we just put the lambda on the other side, do something minus QMC, which is just the quantity with marginal with price equal marginal cost, and here's just what you see here. Here we just substituted. This is exactly the same as this here. So this is QIMC, because if you substitute here for the price marginal cost, you get exactly this here. Okay, so we just added a minus QIMC on both sides. Why did we do that? Yeah, because we can then put it slightly different and make some further arguments here. So here we just put it apart here. That's here the C and the P is substituted. You just go through that. And if you use then what we derived up there, these inverse I need that a minute later. Here I just divided both sides by QI, expanded here with these colored parameters, and you see you get P minus C here, and you get some other parameters, and for P minus C you can substitute this guy here, okay, and what you get is this here. And you might wonder why we are doing this strange stuff, but here's actually a nice result. because this is nothing else than the percentage change or the percentage deviation from first best. Okay? And what we see is that this percentage deviation from first best is actually just this value here. Okay, you should just check whether this is really true. You can do it, and what you really get is the percentage change is the same for all products. We will see that later on, and we can discuss that how fair is such an allocation. Okay, so if you think in terms of freight train services and of passenger train services, no one or no service reaches his first best level, but both services deviate from the first best level at the same percentage. Okay, so that's what we have here. I think I give you another illustration in a minute. Hopefully it gets clearer here. Just some general remark on how realistic that is. Of course, here what you see, our regulator knows both the demand and the costs. Okay, that's complicated. In the real world, or in the real cases we are in, it's often the case that, of course, these prices and are suggested by the infrastructure managers, and of course underlying is some cost estimate, and there is always asymmetric information, but somehow we assume that they can solve this. And the other point is that a nice result, these Ramsey prices. Now the problem is, and that's what I'm going to illustrate in two slides, the distributional effects. Necessities and consumers who cannot switch typically have low elasticity. Okay, you have a low elasticity for electricity, so should you pay a very high price? And is that fair? Okay, just to illustrate that here in this example, we have some average cost curve, and which is above this one, the both individual demands, but if we aggregate them, it's below. So we get cost coverage, and we have two different demands. Demand one would be the inelastic demand, and demand two would be the elastic demand. I gave you the parameters of the problem in the notes, so F is 800. Now, in this next slide, I show you what would be the uniform price. I just calculated that, okay, and you also can do that. We will have a very similar example in the slide. Here you see the uniform price would be 13.8755, okay? Both pay the same. Now, Ramsey prices are slightly different. The inelastic consumers get a higher price. This would be this here. They would have to pay a price of 20, and the elastic consumers, I don't know, it's 16 or something like that. The elastic consumers have to, if it's 40, it's probably, no, it's 10. Okay, but what you see here is that you have two different prices now. And the price decreases for the elastic consumers and increases for the inelastic ones. Why are we doing that? And that's what you get here, because we increase efficiency. You see, of course, the inelastic consumers, there is some loss in gross consumer surplus. This would be the red area. Of course, costs stay the same here, marginal cost of zero, and fixed costs stay the same. But the green area, which is the gain for the low, for the consumers with elastic demand, is larger than the loss here. And that's our efficiency change. Actually, what you see, this efficiency change is really small, because consumer surplus with, and therefore welfare with uniform pricing is 2,379.67, and with Ramsey prices is 2,400. It's just a 1% increase in welfare. Okay? But it's an increase in welfare. However, that's what you see in the next slide. This is now the distributional effects, exactly the same as previously. But here you see how for consumers one, gross consumers or consumer surplus goes down. They previously paid this average price of 13 and now they pay a price of 20. So you see there's quite some redistribution going on. These inelastic consumers lose quite something, okay? The elastic consumers gain quite something. And the question is, as a politician or as a regulator, do you want to get this trouble? Because certainly, I don't know how much the group two will really support you, but the group one really will be annoyed. Okay, that's what you see, and we can discuss that later on as well in the tutorial class. Okay, now that's what it is about nonlinear, about the Ramsey prices, and only very briefly, I want to illustrate two or three other ways to set prices in such a world. I don't go into nonlinear prices. Linear prices just means you say you pay the same price per unit. Nonlinear prices, and the most important example is two-part tariffs, just consider of two parts, namely something like a fixed fee to cover a fixed cost, for instance, or a monthly fee you pay for your smartphone contract or for your telecom for your telephone contract, and you have them some per minute, another per unit fee, might be per minutes, might be per gigabyte, and so on. Okay, and I do that at some length in the I/O course, so I don't want to deal any further here. The only point I want to mention is with these nonlinear prices, with these two-part tariffs, you might even get first best if you have identical consumers, because you could charge fixed fee at the level of the fixed cost and then charge a price per unit fee for the variable cost for the per unit usage. Okay. And again, the basic structure is similar to what a profit maximizing monopolists would do. Two other things which are, I think, rather interesting in current times. This is block pricing. What is block pricing? Now, yeah, here you charge different prices for the different units. This would be something like social tariffs here. Suppose you get the first 3,500 kilowatt hours cheap, because everyone knows everyone needs that, and this is something like a social tariff. If you have more, you're one of these rich heavy users, and if you use even more, you pay much more. That would be, in a sense, this increasing block pricing, some kind of social tariff. Okay? The welfare properties, not so clear at the moment, but at least this is some way or some kind of pricing we see in many countries, in particular in terms of water prices, where you get the base or the base consumption or the necessary consumption of water for a low price. The other thing is declining block prices, which you see here in the right panel. And this is something like just a way to price discriminate. As you see, you try to be close to the demand curve. And that's what you also should have. Just to give you an example of the decreasing block pricing, that's exactly what we have with our EEG, with our renewable energy law. You have to pay 100% of this renewable energy surcharge for your first gigawatt hour. Okay, you have to be a really large company. But then, if you consume more, you only pay 15% of the next. And then it's even further capped. Okay, take a look. Okay, so what you really have in terms of EEG is that very large companies which use electricity heavily, so you have the intensity of electricity usage here, they pay less per kilowatt hour than smaller users. You have exactly this decreasing block pricing. Okay. again, you see it's politically highly disputed whether this is fair. Okay, so I want to jump now not to this excess charge. I will but move on to the peak load pricing, because we have these two because we have this holiday on next Thursday, so I have to make sure that as we have two times the tutorial class, that we cover already the peak load pricing part. I will make a short break here, and then we can briefly discuss that on WebEx and then move on. Okay, getting back to peak load pricing. Peak load pricing in German means Spitzenlastpreise, and this is a problem you have if demand for some products peak at some particular times, like rush hour traffic. If you want to go to Frankfurt either by train or by car on a workday morning, and it's not the corona crisis, you see that there is really rush hour traffic both in trains and in cars. This is a real American example, electricity in late summer afternoons, because there you have all these air conditions running at maximum capacity. In Germany, we have the peak demand in dark and cold January days. And so we have to account for, or we have to make sure that we have sufficient generation capacity here. Ski resorts are typically booked out on weekends or overcrowded. The important point here, and the point why we run into trouble, the good cannot be stored. So you cannot store the electricity you produced via photovoltaic in the summer to the winter time. Okay, at least until now we don't have any significant storage capacity, and therefore you need a capacity investment to meet these peak demands, and that's what we are going to look into right now. So the capacity needs to be built up to meet peak demand, and what does that mean? You waste capacity, you have surplus capacity when demand is low. You have idle generation power plants when during summertime in Germany, okay? Or Pentecost will be soon. We will have negative electricity prices because we produce too much energy. And now the problem is, how do you decide how much capacity to build? And so what you have to cover, of course, are the costs of investing in capacity. And this is what is called long-run marginal cost. Okay, so the long-run marginal cost of increasing supply to meet an increment in peak demand. And that's what you need in order to build and operate this additional capacity. Okay, that's what you have. And so typically, and that's what you have here as well, you set a price equal to this long-run marginal cost in peak demand, and you set a price in off-peak demand where you don't have any additional capacity cost. You set it equal to operating costs or short-run marginal costs. Okay, that's what you often do, and we will see under what circumstances this simple rule holds. So in off-peak demand, you typically have only the additional operating costs, no capacity costs. In peak demand, you if you want to expand or if you want to serve more customers, you have to make an investment in capacity. And so what typically you get is high prices during the peak and low prices off-peak, at least if you have this kind of pricing structure. Okay, and actually, I already mentioned Marcel Boiteau, and he really had a famous another research paper in the end of 1940s, where he derived this peak pricing, and further on, it was introduced by Electricité de France. Okay, now here just the case for a monopolist, and we will have such a situation or such a question or a problem in assignment 5. Here you see the monopolist who has a capacity constraint. That's what you see by this marginal cost curve, which is early on rather flat and then almost gets vertical. That is, capacity constraints are binding here. If you have high demand like this here, and you will set price equal marginal revenue, excuse me, you will set marginal revenue equal to marginal cost, of course, and therefore get the price, which is a high price. And during off-peak times, where your capacity is hardly used, you get much lower prices. Okay, that's what you get. Again, you see the different prices here. Now, what we are doing here, and that's what I'm going to present you, is just a formal analysis where we derive the social optimum. Again, our regulator wants to maximize social welfare, and we assume here for simplicity that there are no economies of scale, no natural monopoly. If we had an economy, if we have some important fixed cost, this would just add a Ramsey-Bourdieu term, and it would just make everything much more complicated. But apart from that, the same kind of argument would hold as we had previously. Okay, now, therefore, it's no break-even constraint, because you can simply set price equal marginal cost and still you don't make any profits here. And what we assume here is, and it's about a standard assumption, the demand for electricity during daytime, QD, is just a function of the price during daytime. And the demand for electricity during nighttime is just a function of the price during nighttime. And now this is an important assumption here. Given the same price, demand during daytime is always higher than during nighttime. So that's where we define peak hours and off-peak hours. Okay, same price, higher demand during peak hours than to off-peak hours. We start with the same setup as previously. We just use gross consumer surplus. Now here we have the quantities, and again, note what I told you. If we take the derivative, if we give our consumer 1 unit more of daytime electricity, the price, which is nothing else than a willingness to pay, tells us by how much this gross consumer surplus increases. And we have some capacity, and we have a strict capacity constraint. If we have only 80 gigawatt hour of production capacity in Germany, we cannot produce more than 80 gigawatt hour in a certain second. Okay, the load cannot be higher. And so we have two types of costs: the marginal operating cost, think it's a gas-fired power plant, then of course this would be the costs for gas, and of course we also have to pay the price for the generation capacity, and here we just assume that this is some capital and rental cost. Okay, that's what we have, and then we start with the optimization problem. Later on you will see that you can really easily calculate or derive that in an intuitive way based on a diagram and simple straightforward distinction of cases. But here I just want to show you the general approach. So we derive the optimum prices and the capacity, and what we have to take into account is a capacity constraint. Now what I'm showing you here looks like a Lagrangian. However, it's a Kuntaka problem. Why is a Kuntaka problem? Because here these are not really constraints which have to be satisfied with equality, but these are non-negativity constraints. What does this mean? Yeah, neither during daytime you can consume more electricity than you have in terms of capacity, nor during night times. Okay, and the point is, however, during night times you will often not use all the capacity. Okay, and therefore it's just idle, and this is not binding here. It's not equal to zero, and that's why it's simply a non-negativity constraint. And lambda d and lambda n, you know already that the lambdas are the Lagrange multipliers are shadow prices. These are the shadow prices on capacity during daytime and nighttime. Okay, if you have idle capacity during the nighttime, okay, you have 80 gigawatt hours of generation capacity, and you have a load of 20 gigawatt, not gigawatt hours, of gigawatt. Okay, I have to do it right. And you have a load of 20 gigawatt, of course, then an extra capacity for you would have a value of zero. Okay, that's the shadow price. And the first order conditions are, as always, just take the derivative with respect to the both quantities and the capacity. And what we have here as well are the so-called complementary slackness conditions, which just state that this condition has to be zero and this condition has to be zero as well. What does this mean? Naja, if this is zero, typically, or if lambda is positive, the shadow price of capacity during daytime, it's clear that you use up all your capacity. If this is positive, if you have excess capacity during nighttime, lambda n must be equal to zero. Okay? In a minute you will see that you don't have to do it in these very formal terms, but here just for the sake of completeness, I put it in formal terms, and here on the next slide you will see how it works in detail. So the shadow price is positive if the capacity constraint is binding. And now here the classic case. What does a classic case mean? Classic case is simply the case where you charge a price equal to long run a peak price equal to long run marginal cost, and the price and the off-peak price equal to short-run marginal cost. So again, just a reproduction, hopefully. Yes, it's just a reproduction of the previous Lagrangian, and we take the derivative. First, the derivative with respect to QD, and you see taking the derivative of the gross consumer surplus with respect to Q is just the respective price. That's why it's so easy. Taking the derivative of variable production with respect to Q, production cost is just CE, and here you get the lambda D from this constraint here. Okay, and the second condition is completely analogous. Again, you get the Pn minus CE minus lambda N. And finally, you have to take the derivative with respect to capacity. Note you also have to determine how much to invest in capacity. Capacity is endogenous, and this would be then just capital here. And so you have the K here, you have it here, and you have it here. Okay, that's what you get here. Okay, and in the classic case, what does it mean? The capacity constraint is binding during peak time, but not binding during off-peak time. Not binding during off-peak time means even though we charge a price equal to marginal cost in off-peak times, capacity is not used up. So, and that would mean if capacity is not binding during off-peak time, remember here our complementary slackness condition, our complementarity slack, if that's positive, if K, the capacity is larger than demand, lambda N will be zero. But if lambda N is zero, we get really nice results here, because if lambda N is zero, you see this thing cancels out and this thing cancels out. And what we see here directly is that Pn is equal CE. The nighttime price, the off-peak price, is just equal to the operating cost, the short-run marginal cost. And we know that lambda D here will be equal to CK. And we just then substitute it here, and we get our immediate result that the daytime price is equal to long-run marginal cost. The nighttime price is equal to short-run marginal cost. Capacity is equal to demand, to daytime demand, evaluated at long-run marginal cost. And of course, that's higher than the demand during off-peak hours during nighttime, given the price is equal to short-run marginal cost. Okay? And actually, that's very easy. What you can directly calculate in all these examples, you just see lambda is equal to zero in the classic case, and you immediately get price equal to in peak times during to these long-run marginal costs. And here, this diagram from Josko, just to illustrate that, first of all, here you see why we have a peak and off-peak demand here. Here you see if you have some price, you see in peak hours, this would be the peak demand, this would be the off-peak demand, okay? And you see this off-peak, peak demand is for a given price is always higher than off-peak demand. This was our basic assumption, okay? Now, here you have the short-run marginal cost. Here you have, so the difference between the two here is just the CK, the capacity or investment cost. And what you have here is you charge a price equal to short-run marginal cost to consumers here during off-peak hours, and you get this nighttime demand. Okay, you charge a price to equal to long-run marginal cost during daytime, that is during peak hours, and what you then determine is simply your capacity. Okay, and of course here it's vertical because you cannot produce more than that, but that is what you get here. Okay, simply it's very easy to do. The problem, you only get problems once you get the shifting peak. And I just want to illustrate that by means of the diagram here. Here, the shifting peak, in German, a very nice word, wandernde Lastspitze. So here again, you have peak hours and off-peak hours. Okay, peak demand and off-peak demand. Again, you see peak demand is always higher than off-peak demand during the same time. But what you see here is what happens if you charge a long-run price equal marginal cost. Your demand will then be, your peak demand will be this here, okay? And if you charge a price equal to short-run marginal cost in off-peak hours, your demand will be this here. Okay, so that is, you have a higher demand in off-peak hours than in peak hours. And of course, that's a bad thing because if you build up just this capacity, you run into trouble. You run into trouble because you have excess demand in off-peak hours. Actually, the best example I can come up with is a so-called schöne Wochenende ticket by the Deutsche, I think at that time it was still even Deutsche Bundesbahn, a nice weekend ticket. And they thought, so what are the marginal costs for an additional passenger if you have an empty train? It's pretty much zero, okay? And what was the case about trains on weekends some 20 years ago? Prices were rather high, but trains were empty. So what they said, okay, we price almost according to marginal cost there. And actually at that time, I think a schöne Wochenende ticket, nice weekend ticket, cost just 15 Deutschmark, and it was valid for five people. So you had 3 Deutschmark, and you could use all regional trains, regional passenger trains in whole over Germany. And what we ended up with bowling clubs going from south of Bavaria to the island of Sylt over the weekend. And we had complete overcrowding of these trains in the very beginning and on the weekends. Okay, so that was really, in my view, an example of this wandernde Lastspitze. So, of course, that cannot be a nice solution, and that's what we are doing then right here. What happens if the situation is different? The capacity constraint is binding always, okay? That's what you just saw. The capacity constraint is binding. We cannot just simply set short-run marginal cost equal to off-peak price and long-run marginal cost equal to peak price. And if that applies, of course, we will have the situation I just illustrated, okay? Given we have the long-run marginal cost as price for daytime, the demand is lower than given we have a short-run marginal cost price, demand is during nighttime. And therefore, we will have the situation that QD, that both demand or demand always is equal to capacity. That's what we have to guarantee. Okay? And therefore, we know lambda n is no longer zero. And from this condition here, we get a situation that lambda n is, or that lambda d plus lambda n is equal to ck. But if we have that, it's rather straightforward, because then if lambda d is then, we can just substitute here, we know then that Pn, as lambda n is positive, Pn must be greater than Ce, and Pd, as lambda d is of course Ck minus lambda n, is smaller than the long-run marginal cost. And K is also higher than the demand given the long-run, peak demand given the long-run marginal cost. This all sounds rather complicated, but you will see actually that's where you have the prices. I mentioned that. But it's actually straightforward once you get the specific examples, because that's what you can already derive here. Here, what is, I just erase that part again here. So what will be the price? So what you see here with the two demand functions, actually, we just could say, is that an optimal capacity? Then the willingness to pay above variable cost would be this here. And we would have, so of the off-peak demand, and they would actually pay or alone already all the costs. Okay, so the point is here we are looking for a situation where, and this is exactly what is depicted here, where off-peak demand pays a little bit of the capacity cost, and the rest is paid by peak demand, and actually this small part would be equal to that small part. Okay, so just this is like in a public goods problem. Capacity is like a public good; it can both use peak and off peak. And now, if off peak users also pay something for capacity, that's what in a sense can be saved. For the price which can be reduced for peak users. That's what we have here. And again, peak load pricing is something we get in electricity. And here I have an example from a commission staff working document where we have the question whether we can or whether we need what is called capacity markets. What we have here is a so-called merit order curve. Here you have the different technologies with the different costs. This would be the cost of technology one, would be nuclear, for instance. This would be the cost for marginal cost or the variable cost for technology two, which typically would be lignite or brown coal. This would be tech three, would be something like hard coal. And this would be Steinkohle. And this would be technology four. This would be something like gas. And what we have here, you have three different demands. This would be nighttime demand, daytime demand, and this would be extremely high daytime demand during winter times. And what you see here is, here, if you have even fixed cost, and that's why it's important, if demand is this, price will be equal to marginal cost of the second technology. Second technology can just cover its marginal cost, but the first technology gets some rectangle here to cover part of its fixed cost. during daytime, both technologies cover some of the fixed cost, okay? And during nighttime, we even get scarcity prices, namely prices which are higher than marginal cost because we have capacity restraints. And we have to have such high prices that demand is pushed back to capacity, and we get some, here all three technologies earn some revenue, and even gas would earn some revenue. The question is always whether it's sufficiently. And here we have a huge discussion currently, how high can these prices, these scarcity prices, go? They might be as high as 3,000 euro per megawatt hour. The usual price currently is about 40 or even less per megawatt hour. This is also, I think, an interesting story, and I could tell you much more, but I think I should leave it at this. Unfortunately, I couldn't tell you this nice case. I think you can go through it in some detail, German track access price system, track access charges system. You will see that everything, actually the European Commission has a system or has law. This really starts with Ramsey and the ability to pay, at least one can interpret it that. And in Germany, this system was really introduced. You see, the Federal Network Agency had even from the Bundesverkehrswegeplan, the Federal Transport Infrastructure Plan, some elasticities. That's what I previously mentioned. We get different charges. Perhaps we do another, at some time, do another seminar on railways, because I think this is part topic where regulatory economists are in high demand. I was giving acting as an expert appointed by the Austrian regulator, Schienen Control, in order to check whether the Austrian infrastructure manager, ÖBB Infrastructure, got their track access charges right. There were some problems there. Anyway, a very interesting topic. However, I think I have to leave it at this and have to move on next week with, in 2 weeks. We only will meet again in 2 weeks. So what I say here is just thank you for being with me. And it was tough content, so we will move on discussing that in more detail in the tutorial class, and hopefully it gets clearer once we introduce these examples, in particular once we restrict ourselves to independent demand in the Ramsey prices. But anyway, so thank you for your attention, and see you on WebEx a little bit, and apart from that, meet you again in 2 weeks. Goodbye.